Hi, good morning, Delhi. I'm very pleased to be here today. Thank you, Entrepreneur, for inviting me and also publishing some of my articles. To add to the introduction, the Bissell family is the owner of Fab India. And today I have the pleasure to dive into the world of the challenges that multimillionaires and billionaires in India face with Ms. Rajmohan Krishnan from Bangalore and Ms. Dhanuka from Gurgaon. So the topic today is that we're going to discuss how we can bridge the gap between startups raising funds from family and friends and fools, and also from venture capital, and we will discuss whether family offices will be able to bridge that gap. But before I come to that, I would like to introduce both panelists and then start slightly differently, but come back to that question. So Rajmohan, we've had the pleasure to work together on a few deals. So Rajmohan lived in Delhi. He co-founded the private banking space with Kotak, has been there for many decades before he decided to start his own company called Entrust. And what Rajmohan does is he manages multiple family offices. One of the most known persons probably in his families is Nandini Likhani. We've done one investment together in a Delhi-based startup called Juggernaut. And Rajmohan has been the man behind the deal of Nandini Likhani investing in Fab India. So there is a huge trust level between the Bissell family and the Nilekhanis, and this is all due to Rajmohan's hard work, which is done hidden and behind. Thank you, Rajmohan, for being here. Mr. Dhanuka, unfortunately, we've not been working together so far, but I believe that might change. So to give you a little bit of background, so he's the founder of a platform that's going to focus on transportation and smart mobility. And in addition to that, Mr. Dhanuka is also working and advising family offices through the SAR group out of Gurgaon. And the exciting thing about this is that they're going to focus on startups that are working in air pollution, in the air pollution field around logistics, transportation, and many other fields. So for all startups out there, this is a chance to get identified by the family and Mr. Dhanuka. So, as I said, the topic is whether family offices will be able to bridge the gap between family and friends and venture capitalists. But before that, both of you, please let me know what are the challenges that a family office face, and why do they start investing through a family office, and also, yeah, how do they, what challenges do Indian rich families face? Why do they start family offices, and how can you support them?
So let me divide family offices into two. Today, India is has multiple families who have made money in the last about two decades, and typically, if you look at, there are business families and there are professional families, okay? And professional families, I would say professional entrepreneurs who have made money. These are first generation or max second generation. Whereas you have legacy wealth, okay, which is some of the brick and mortar companies or some of the large families which have made a lot of wealth. So when you look at the challenges for both are completely different. It's not the same. So typically, if you take large families which has got legacy wealth, the most important, I would say, the challenge is preservation of wealth and probably the succession of the monies which they have made across generations. So typically, you'll find when there are multiple family members, there are multiple interests, and typically it's not the same. And each one wants to pursue their own interests. So unless you create a kind of a constitution, a council, in order to probably empower each family member to pursue their own, it's not going to be successful. If you look at a professional family, whereas it's simple, it's mostly nuclear families, you will not find many family members. So the needs and probably the decision making is quick, and where you will not find complexity in terms of decision making. And there the challenges are different in terms of you look at what will the family, what is the kind of thinking the family has got in terms of what is a value, what they see money as, okay. And most of them would not want to probably continue running businesses. Most of the professionals, if you see, have invested in startups, mentoring startups, and working with budding entrepreneurs, and also involved very much into social investing. Social investing is a big thing today. People have realized, saying that just plain philanthropy will not work. And so that is one area where people are extremely focused. And so this is, so if you look at the challenges are twofold and different for different families. You would want to add something?
Yeah, so, you know, I would possibly, rather than going to challenges, I would look at it from the motivations perspective on, you know, why are we doing what we are doing, you know? So, you know, at the end of the SAR Group's family office, where, you know, Rakesh Malhotra, who's a first generation entrepreneur, you know, after having created or rather started Luminous inverters and batteries from scratch way back in 1988, after, you know, sort of building it from scratch into a prominent brand in the power backup space for India, sold Luminous to Schneider in 2011. Now, you know, when I came on board right after that exit, the thought was, what next? You know, on one side, what we have is the operating business is out and we have loads of cash. So on one side, it was about consolidating on what we understand as a group, which is what it is to take build brands in a country as diverse and complex like India, and what is it to scale distribution networks for such brands. So those are two things which the group understands. So, you know, how can you consolidate those strengths and, you know, get on a serial entrepreneurship zone to start new businesses? So that was one direction. The other direction was, and then, you know, on that direction, we went ahead and forced entry into businesses like air purification, water purification, energy storage, electromobility. On the other side, it was to say that we don't know all of it, and we can't innovate everything inside our R&Ds. So the approach to investing or the approach to going out into the market was primarily to say that let us combine our strengths of what we understand about the Indian market, the complexities of the Indian market, and combine it with innovation which comes from early stage entrepreneurs, because we can't create all of that internally. So the motivation, you know, to sort of get to your question, the motivation at our end was, can we create a host of 8 to 10 companies with early stage entrepreneurs who bring in the technology, who bring in the product in spaces like consumer IoT, electromobility, clean technologies, and we bring in capital, and we bring in patient capital rather, which is not having a pressure of exit for 5 to 7 years. It's at least available for a decade long. Some very deep strategic intent to scale those businesses together. So I think therefore it's a very unique way of looking at it in terms of the product with, or the investor who is on the table, who is aligned with you for long term. I think that's where I would get to, you know, in terms of the motivation of doing what we are doing.
Okay, thank you. I don't know how many of you in this room are already millionaires, so many things that we're discussing now might not feel close to what you might experience at the moment, but you're in the money room, so I expect you to have that vision or goal. So we're coming to this now, how if you have started a business, how you can raise money in one of the next questions. But before that, What are the two or three trends that you see how super rich Indians invest? And is startup and investing in startups included in one of these trends or not, so that we can answer in the next question how they can approach you? So what are the trends that you see in super rich Indians investing in India?
So, to sort of talk in our case specifically, I think we have had a three-pronged strategy, you know, and on the investing side, beyond the public markets investing, which is, which is a separate vertical altogether. On the private side, the things which we have been doing is, one, the strategic investments piece, where we would go out and take major minority stakes. So we would go out and take 26 to 49% stake into companies, where we join hands to build businesses together. Those are in the spaces of consumer IoT, home automation, energy management, clean technologies, air purification, water purification, and electromobility, and clean transportation or smart mobility around drivetrain technologies, electric vehicles, and stuff around that. So that's the strategic investment piece, where tickets of $500,000 to almost $5 million for 26 to 49% stakes. That's one piece where we think we can collaboratively add value for long term. The second piece is stuff which we think is sunrise, but we don't understand. So there we would go out and take LP positions in venture funds and co-invest with them in their portfolio companies, right? So essentially saying that if it is fintech, if it is health tech, if it is ed tech, there is value to be created there, but let the best fund managers evaluate and deploy funds there. So therefore, take LP positions and co-invest with them. So we have almost like 5 to 6 track record funds in India and done co-investments with them in India. The third and final piece is early stage angel investments, where again we are part of syndicates where lead investor is someone else. So we are still a passive investor, but if a prominent CXO or a prominent lead investor goes out and says that there is merit in participating in a team like this, we would go out and, on the trust and confidence of that lead investor, participate with him. Not to say that, so we end up meeting 2 to 3 entrepreneurs every day, and all of that is not invested at our end. So we would then put them across to some of the other investor or mentor and see if there is merit in that opportunity, we will participate through that expert route than doing it ourselves directly. So I think it's a three-pronged strategy, and definitely startups are part of it.
Okay, and Rajmohan, what trends do you see?
See, actually, I would look at this way. When you're looking at investing into a startup, always you look at what is a potential exit for the investment. So in India, if you look at family office as a concept, is just taken off. In fact, in the last probably about 5-6 years, you find some of the entrepreneurs have set up single family offices, and there are few, I would say, multi-family offices which is existing. None of them have typically seen exits in terms of their investments. It's all in the investment mode. So if you look at, people are extremely cautious when they look at kind of a, I talk on behalf of about 30 odd investors, 30 odd families, which I work for. So typically, and if they're looking at investing, they look at investing into areas which they're comfortable. Like typically, if you're working with a pharma-based promoter, he'll be very comfortable in pharma-based businesses or relative kind of businesses. If you're working with a technology-based promoter, so he'll be very comfortable in terms of tech-based investments. Yeah. Okay, very few investments will be outside tech. Okay, so even then, investors look at investments where they can probably participate, mentor, and be able to have a say in terms of what they're investing. Okay, like what Sumit said, and what we have two different perspectives, because Sumit works very closely with a single family office where they've got very clear strategy in terms of where they are looking at. But typically when we work on behalf of many families, so each of them have got their own perspective in terms of investing. So I would say still we are scratching the surface in terms of private equity investments. So typically there's a long way to go. That's the way I put it.
Okay, and if the young founders out there wanna approach you and are hoping that you're bridging the gap between family and friends money and VC money, which is probably in the $250,000-$500,000 space, well, $500,000 probably early stage VCs will do as well. Do you think you can bridge that gap, and how can they approach you, and when should they approach you, all the men and women out there with the entrepreneurs?
So I think at our end, again, incidentally, a few deals which we have been doing in the last few months, most of them fall in that bracket, you know, where the founder from his own pocket, out of his bootstrapped venture and friends and family money, which he has been able to accumulate, you know, he has brought the venture from a point of starting it up, say, year and a half, 2 years, 2.5 years back, to a point of getting some pieces of the product right. So I would say getting to a prototype and getting some sense of how the market looks at it in terms of you know, customer feedback. So therefore, most of it in our case, I would say, are those situations where we would also want to get them young, get them very early in the stage of, because when it is collaborative value creation where we bring the brand and brand and distribution, essentially there has to be alignment of those ventures to the larger vision of the group, right? So therefore, you cannot get into them very late in the life cycle. So the moment there is alignment, and I think the other important thing is there are varied kind of entrepreneurs. There are entrepreneurs who know what I want to do, and you don't need to sort of, I just need capital as the input. Then we are very clear that we are not the right guys for you. You know, the guys who know that, who are really in need for fast track to commercialization of their products through brand and distribution, which we bring on the table, only then it makes sense to collaborate. So we are definitely in that zone of, I would say, pre-VC stage. And then because of the access of a, you know, domestic and global investor network at our end. So therefore, we don't see challenges to capital access. We don't see those entrepreneurs running around independently alone, because then we are in the same boat and wanting to sort of be with them throughout life cycle.
So coming back, I would say when firstly, when we evaluate a firm, because we are allocating money on behalf of our investor, we'll be extremely careful and diligent in terms of where we want to invest our monies in. Okay, the first is we look at the kind of zeal and the kind of enthusiasm with the promoter. Okay, whether we see the fire in the eyes in terms of saying that there is something which will make it happen. Number two, I would say the proof of concept. Basically, they've started, they've probably come up to a stage where there's a proof of concept, we can see something happening, and typically that is when you feel a little comfortable in terms of probably investing. And one is on the, so we do an industry analysis also, because we don't stick to probably, so we are sector agnostic, so we see across sectors. So we really look into the sectors, probably understand, saying that what is the kind of scale which can reach, okay? And scale is something which is very critical. And having worked with a kind of large families, we understand that scale is something which is possible in India, okay? If you're talking to billions of people. So end of the day, that's going to work. And so typically we see the scale, we see the proof of concept, we see the promoter background, and then go ahead.
Okay. And let's assume for a moment that you've started your company, you've worked your ass off, you found very good marquee investors like we have on stage and the investors they're representing, and you get your exit. And now you find yourself in a position where you're ultra rich, new in. When is the time this new rich Indian should approach you? When is the time they should think about setting up a family office? What is your advice when they have this huge check in hand and don't know what to do with it, maybe?
So actually, the minute you have money, you have tens and thousands of opportunities knocking at your door. So one needs to be extremely sane, extremely diligent in terms of what they want to do with the money. So typically, staying quiet for some time makes a lot of sense, and not just get over exuberant and probably start investing into various opportunities. And see, I would say family office is something where it depends on the nature of the family, nature of so somebody is extremely overwhelmed with what do you say, the work and opportunities and passions, what they want to do. Of course, then you need something like to set up a family office. And so just getting money alone doesn't qualify for somebody to set up a family office, according to me. Money is one criteria. Number two is in terms of what they would want to do in terms of the future. They want to run the business, or they want to probably chill. So it depends on individuals and their choices. And once they decide what exactly they want to do, and that is when the choice comes. So what we do is we engage with the promoters even before they see money. Okay, and in various capacities, we work with a firm, we do business advisory. So we do a lot of other activities with the promoters. We handhold them. So once they are in the money, they are already in sort of in good hands in terms of probably we'll be able to advise them properly in terms of what they need to do. So typically that's how we approach the entire thing. Yeah.
Okay.
So maybe what I would like to add, the way it happened in Rakesh's case, I think the scale and size of what Luminous got to in 25 years, the second innings was to actually do five times of what you created in 25 years in 1/5 of the time, right? So which means that, because you have seen it and done that once, you want to see that can you go out and do it one other time at a very different scale, right? So, it was 1,000 crore of turnover or 1,100 or that sort at Luminous when he exited. The plan is now to get to $1 billion, in terms of the next mission. It was 25 years then, it is 5 years now. So I think it again boils down to motivations of what I want to do after I have created that money. For some, and I think most of the, many entrepreneurs are now, after exiting from their businesses very early in their life cycle, primarily in the technology space, getting on to the serial entrepreneurship zone, where there is one next idea to sort of catch hold of and run after it, right? Whereas, so it boils down to what is it that I want to do. And I think there is a lot of discovery which happens because you do not have answers of it right away after that exit. So, you essentially give yourself that time to discover. I don't think we had all the answers in way back in 2011. There was discovery between 2011 and 2013 in terms of what do you want to do next. And in that process of discovery, you did some mistakes, you did things which did not work for you, and got to a point where you understood that these are the next big things which you want to run after. So I think it's, investing is part of that journey where many entrepreneurs now say that, can I help and give back to the entrepreneurial ecosystem of what I have learned and help entrepreneurs not make the mistakes which, they can learn from me. So I think, and a lot of them even getting to philanthropy big time to say that, capital is something which is not just that I have created, I have the benefit of now creating impact with a large number of people in the ecosystem. So, again, that's another motivation in terms of getting out after an exit, yeah.
Okay, and before we open up to all the questions from the audience, one last question coming back to the topic. If you think of bridging this gap between family and friends and venture capitalists, where do you see family offices? And do you think they can really bridge the gap? So where is the difference between you and a typical angel investor and a venture capitalist. Some things have been mentioned, like you might be more patient, you might have a different motivation, but in two or three sentences as a summary, what makes family offices outstanding as investors?
Definitely patient capital, but how patient? It's a big question mark. I would say better than angel investors, venture funds or something like that. But I would not definitely compare it to the institutions, because institutions have got a different mindset in terms of when they come and invest. And they are very, very long-term in nature, in fact. And as we speak, in India, family offices are very nascent. We're just scratching the surface. And it's not like some of the evolved family offices in the US, which has transcended generations. And it's been more institutionalized, I would say. And where money is being managed for a very, very long-term basis and not looking at a kind of a short and medium term. And that's what I mentioned in the first, when we discussed the first question. It's like still we are a long way to go in terms of this. But still I would say there is an opportunity to be explored with family offices. Interesting concepts, interesting ideas can always be backed up and funded. I'm sure there is this much more opportunity there. Yeah.
So I think to just add, I would say yeah, definitely patient capital, but definition of patience is different for every investor. So, but you know, for us, it's if we are into it for collaborative value creation, the direction is not to go out and exit that business and make some quick money. So you want to take it to some serious scale before you want to get out of it. So which means that it aligns with the timeline or the horizon of that entrepreneur very well. But we caution the entrepreneur right at the word go to let him know of who is he entering into, because it's again a marriage, right? And you know, if he is smart enough to do all that is required to scale his venture and he only requires capital, then we are not the right guys. So which means that sensitization happens from our side to say that we are relevant for you or not. So therefore, I think the option is definitely available, but the entrepreneur has to be very sure of who is he getting in touch with as an investor.
Okay, and if you allow one more question before we open up to the Q&A, assuming the young men and women out there, they got their check after the exit and they don't get so super excited that they spend it immediately on all the yachts, airplanes, cars. You can, don't spend everything. And if they're thinking beyond spending it immediately, beyond investing again, they want to pass it on to their family and family members in future, what are things and mistakes they should avoid or consider as per your view, where you believe you are stronger than traditional wealth managers and others in supporting them through decades?
See, actually, in India, succession planning is not—it's not something which is caught up like in the West. Though we are seeing traces of it. As you are aware, in India, insurance is bought as an investment and not as a cover. And so typically everyone is always questioned saying that what is in it for me? But if you look at in terms of if you want to pass on the money to the successive generations, if you want to properly safeguard the wealth, what you've created, and it's not that everybody, and we have seen by experience, it's not that every entrepreneur who's set up a business and probably exited successfully has made multiple successful exits. Okay, so it's a challenge, actually. It's not possible. So few people have been lucky. And so most of the people, have not been so lucky as others. So I would say safeguarding wealth is one of the most important critical things. And as a family office, we advise promoters to probably not get into too much of exuberance in terms of, spraying and praying in terms of probably investing everywhere whoever comes to you. Be extremely careful, diligent in terms of what they do, have a family trust set up transfer all the monies into the trust, have a succession plan in place, and oversee the succession as you are there, and have clear asset allocation in mind, saying that if even if you want to probably allocate money, how much of your money has to be allocated to a kind of a startup or probably some unlisted companies, what you want to invest. Not everything what you want to probably invest will go into an unlisted kind of an opportunity. So we're very careful in terms of advising the families in terms of how they need to approach when they have money in hand. And so that's how the process goes on. And it's always, as Sumit was mentioning, it's again individual to individual, it differs. The mindset differs, the risk-taking ability differs, and what they want to do in life differs. So it's like not one size fits all. So you'll have to have solutions for different people, and that's the job of kind of a multifamily office. Yeah.
Okay.
Sure. I think you know, most of it is said. I think the important part is of this entire agenda is a very thought through asset allocation. So, you know, when you plan for that, you know, out of the entire corpus, you make sure that enough of it is kept in the conservative portfolio, which is not subject to risk, where principal protection is taken care of. And it's, you know, it's a very small portion which gets in as an allocation to risk assets, right? High risk, you know, high return kind of an assets, right? And, you know, on succession, I think definitely, you know, so you have the trust structures in place ahead of time so that, you know, you have the entire roadmap to how this will get to the next generation. And I think there is parallel activity to mature your next generation to take things up from you, right? So, you know, the family members are essentially getting trained, you know, with the expectation that the pace of that training is, you know, enough for them to take over or take up things in reasonable period of time. So I think beyond the legality of it, there is activity to make sure that, you know, there is competence and capabilities getting built in the next generation to take things up. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I would like to open up to the audience for any questions you might have. And if you do, please keep your introduction short so many more have the chance to ask. And if you have follow-on questions, I would request you to do that offline. Thanks.
Hi. My name is Vikram, and I work with early stage entrepreneurs, helping them raise money from people like yourselves. One of the questions I had for you is, you clearly, you work with a lot of very successful entrepreneurs who've made money and have very clear ideas about business, how business should be done, how businesses should be scaled. Do you find that there is sometimes a conflict between those people whose money you're investing and the people who you're investing it into?
A little bit louder, please.
I said, do you find that there's a conflict between, sometimes there's a conflict about how to scale a business between the entrepreneurs whose money you're investing and the companies that you're investing it into? Because those guys are still sort of getting started. These guys are already established, have very clear views of how businesses should be run. And there might be a conflict sometimes. Is that something that you encounter, and how would you manage it? Because you're coming in between the company you're investing in and the person whose funds you're investing.
So I could not get the question completely, but from what I understand, what you say, and let me know if that's the question. So what I understand is you're asking is conflict in those who have built businesses and who are now investors and their preconceived notions of how do businesses get built.
Yes.
Versus the new age entrepreneurs who have their ideas of how to build business.
That's right.
Right. So I think, you know, first of all, we are very clear from day one that when it comes to businesses being built today, you know, the way of doing that has very little to take from. So the fundamentals stay, right? But the way of doing that in terms of the way of scaling, the channels in which you go out and scale are completely different. So which means that there has to be enough autonomy given to each of the ventures where one would invest into to go and play their own shots. So it's like a test match which we played in the last first innings, and now they're coming into playing a 2020 game, right? The fundamentals and the rules of the game are completely different. Now, there is no possibility of us to stifle those entrepreneurs in going out and playing their own game. So which means that, at our end, we know that we don't know the answers. It is the entrepreneur who is in the driving seat, and he has to take the directions the way he finds when he's on that journey. So I think it's more an enablement thing and a coaching thing than saying that this is how things have to be done. I don't know if it answers your question. Yeah.
I asked the same question in the last panel. Do you fund SMEs? Because most of the family businesses are SME businesses. Are you in favor, or you are also the same notions that you are looking for IT companies and all that? Do you look for traditional businesses? Or you are looking for IT companies or networking company?
No, I don't think you can brand it as an IT or a technology-based kind of an investment. Startup is about a business idea, okay? Mm-hmm. And if the idea is good, obviously you will have all ears for the kind of opportunity what you're bringing in. And you will have, not everybody will be interested in a particular idea. Like I think last panel also, I think somebody spoke, I think Avishkar Vinit Rai spoke about it. I think you will have enough of people who are extremely, interested in, ideas like what yours. I think you are into printing ink, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I think definitely there'll be opportunities for people who are outside technology, outside, the new generation businesses.
But where do we pitch these ideas to? That's what I was looking here, that I would find somebody who can read my idea or listen to my idea. But I found that all the venture capital is looking for majorly IT products. So I couldn't find one. So that's what my query is. This was the same query, last panel I put it, and same as yours.
Hi, if I may step in here. Follow-on questions, please, offline. I see a lot of ladies here, which I like. So if you have questions, please feel free. I know that sometimes it's a bit harder for you to come out and ask, but please do. And if there is any other question from the audience, please use this chance, because they're both representing amazing investors and have a lot of industry experience and will be able to guide you through fundraise and other questions if you have. So if there are no other questions, then enjoy lunch if you get lunch here. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Well, thank you very much indeed. I'm going to request our panel members to please remain on the stage. And if I may please request Ms. Angela to please present the token of gratitude to fellow panel members first up. And just a little note for our members of the audience, we're not serving lunch as yet. We are about to get started with our next session as well. Invite Ms. Punita Kapoor, the assistant editor for Entrepreneur Media, to please come on stage and also present the gift to our session lead, Ms. Angela.